At LaGrange College, you'll find your professors to be encouragers, trusted role models, mentors. Discover learning relationships that transform at one of the South's most affordable, highly ranked institutions. Challenging minds, inspiring souls, transforming lives. Discover more at lagrange.edu/transform.
For some people, success is defined by the make of the car they drive or the size of the house they own. For others, success is being able to buy whatever you want, whenever you want it. When it comes to making a living, however, not everyone spells success in dollar signs. According to a recent survey of 27,500 randomly selected people representing 198 occupations, a successful career includes the opportunity to help and teach other people. In the next few minutes, we'd like to introduce you to 8 people who have found successful careers. Successful careers helping and teaching other people. They love what they do, they love where they do it. And they just happen to work at LaGrange College.
LaGrange College presents.
I failed over and over and over again in my life, and that is why I succeed. Michael Jordan. Dr. Toni Anderson is one of the most respected and admired members of the LaGrange College faculty. She's earned success as an educator, administrator, and performer. But her dream of success as an author, writing a book about the famous Fisk Jubilee Singers, seemed like it would never happen. Even after years and years of research, still an important piece of the puzzle was missing. Missing until one day when she stumbled upon a chest full of long-lost letters.
The Jubilee Singers were not initially the Jubilee Singers. They were just a choir. And George White, who was the treasurer and the music director, the choir director at Fisk University, had formed this group together, and they practiced in his parlor during half of their lunch hour. They gave up half of their lunch hour to sing together. And when the school began to literally go under because of lack of funding, it was his idea to take this group on the road and raise money for the school. And it was not initially supported. This idea was not initially supported, but he went anyway. They had months of lots of trials and tribulations from October 7th when they left until December when they finally made it to New York City and sang at Henry Ward Beecher's church. And from that moment forward, they were celebrated and embraced by the Christian community initially, and then the wider community eventually. And from that point, they went across the pond to Europe, where they sang for all the crowned heads of Europe. And that's when their fame exploded. That's also when money started coming back home, which saved Fisk University. That's their story in a nutshell. There were a few articles out, but no one had really done book-length treatment of the subject. So when I discovered that, and the deeper I started digging, all of this material started surfacing, and it was amazing, and I felt like I had discovered this lost treasure. And in some ways I had, because every time I went back to Fisk University, to their special collections, I would discover something new. And I became friends with the archivist there. Her name is Beth House, a beautiful, lovely lady, who happens to also be the great-grandchild of one of the original singers. One day, I was sort of just trailing behind her, and we walked back towards the archives, which at that point were not fully cataloged. And I looked down, and there was this black trunk, and on the top of it was stamped FJS. We looked at it, and it was all of these letters from field agents during the original tours, and it felt like we were opening them for the first time since the 1870s. And that was pretty cool. It is a remarkable story. That partnership of both African Americans and whites working for a common cause is a good thing for us to talk about. And it has a lot of meaning for people. It's an eye-opener for many, and for many it's a fresh new story. With many audiences, several of the groups that I've spoken to they're not that familiar with Negro spirituals. So that whole aspect of the story is new revelation to them. There's a lot there to talk about and celebrate together. And that's what makes the story very rewarding to talk about and to write about.
Flaming enthusiasm, backed up by horse sense and persistence, is the quality that most frequently makes for success. Dale Carnegie. Professor Tim Talton has been with the LaGrange College Department of Art and Design since 1984. Over the years, he's seen a tremendous number of students achieve success. So how does an instructor stay successful inside and outside the classroom for nearly 30 years? By remaining intellectually curious, by encouraging students to look for the fun in every project, and by not always knowing the answer to everything.
3D design and sculpture and ceramics, all three of my beginning classes are open to all students. We sort of, in 3D, we explore different medias, like we use ceramics, we use balsa wood and wood and metal. Different things, and sometimes it's anything goes. You know, it's a found object. Duchamp took a stool and a wagon wheel and mounted them together and called it found art. You know, found object art. And basically, by taking them out of their original settings and putting them together, he creates these sort of interesting narrative sculptures. You know, even though they're just objects. Students now, when they come in, have already taught themselves a lot of the basics because they've grown up playing with Photoshop and different computer software, and so they're up on it, you know. And it sort of changes the playing field a lot of times in terms of what you can achieve within a classroom, because you can just keep going with it. You know, they already know some of this stuff, and some don't. And the nice thing about LaGrange College, I think, is that you get that variety in a classroom, and it's sort of the way we teach. We're all used to it here. We're used to teaching people who come in with not much in that background versus kids who come in, you know, and they've been swimming in it their whole life. I don't like making it sound like I know it all about it. I'm there to explore, you know, and a lot of times with the students. I mean, that's what we do. That's what we do here at this college. We learn and work with the students. When we can take one to that next level, that's when it's, you know, it gets really exciting. And then they challenge us, you know, us to really get beyond our limits as well. So that's fun. It's what makes the job, you know. I mean, it really is. When you have students like that, that really make you go home and go, I had a good day today, you know. Somebody just did something that was just incredible. You know, that's when it all becomes worth it. You know?
I don't know the key to success, but the key to failure is trying to please everybody. Bill Cosby. Fall convocation at LaGrange College, a formal assembly of faculty and students that brings the academic community together to celebrate the beginning of a new school year. Guests were welcomed by Provost David Garrison.
This convocation is the moment we call ourselves together to mark the start of the final year of those approaching graduation and the initial year of those beginning their college experience.
And then LaGrange College President Dan McAlexander introduced the keynote speaker, Dr. Arthur Robinson.
Tirelessly, enthusiastically, and most effectively, Dr. Robinson assists this campus community in its research and discovery. I have heard more than once that his quick mind, extraordinary classical education, and dedication make him able and willing to work miracles and achieve the impossible when it comes to unearthing resources.
I too went to a small liberal arts college. I realized, looking back, that some of the things I'm most glad I did in college were things that at the time I felt guilty about. And no, I don't mean what you think. I mean the courses I took because I wanted to, even though I was sure they'd be of no practical use. And the times I devoted to my favorite hobby, procrastination. Back then, I thought I was just having fun and wasting time. But I don't think so now. When I started college, they told us that a liberal arts education would prepare us not just for a career, but for life. They said that the skills we acquired in all our courses would be applicable to whatever career we chose. I'm not sure I believed them then, but I believe it now. My message, if any, is pretty basic. It's simply to take advantage of your college years. For some of you, it's your next 4 years. For those of you who are seniors, it's just one more year. We hope. But however long it is, I urge you to take full advantage of your time at LaGrange College. You'll probably never have so much freedom again. And I don't mean that to sound pessimistic, because for most of you, your best times will probably come when you have families and careers. But families and careers do limit your free time somewhat. So take advantage of the freedom you now have. And I don't mean by partying all night, but by exploring your interests and being open to new interests, both in and out of the classroom. I hope you'll all find that you have more interest when you leave college than you had when you began it. I know I do. Thank you.
Success consists of going from failure to failure without loss of enthusiasm. Winston Churchill. English professor Dr. Anthony Wilson believes that there are two kinds of college students, the ones who love to write and the ones who consider it a chore. Being able to write is essential to success in college. So the challenge before Dr. Wilson is clear. Somehow he has to make writing less of a chore for his students who don't enjoy writing. Mission impossible? No. Dr. Wilson says the key is simple. His students have to be convinced that what they have to say is important.
I think a lot of students get discouraged because they've had a very kind of rules-oriented approach in their writing instruction. They think, well, essay has to be 5 paragraphs. If I make 3 grammar errors, I'm going to flunk, that sort of a thing. Writing becomes, in a lot of students' minds, something artificial, right? A hoop that you jump through, and not what it fundamentally is, which is an expression of your own voice and your own thoughts. One of my colleagues, Lane Scott, often starts out a class in sort of freshman level literature, asking, you know, who likes to read? Who likes poetry, for example? And often we'll get lukewarm responses, right? And so she'll say, well, she'll hold up a Dr. Seuss book, for example, and say, remember this? Remember the joy that you got as a kid reading this, the fun that you had with language? What happened to that? You know? And again, I think it's a matter of finding that point at which what was a joy for a lot of students became something else and figuring out how to rectify that. For me, it never became anything but a joy. And so I think, you know, my love of language really dovetails with what I do perfectly. You know, I really take joy in reading eloquent prose. I really take joy in reading well-expressed thoughts. And I hope that my students end up doing the same.
Try not to become a man of success, but rather try to become a man of value. Albert Einstein.
My name is Arya Allami. I'm from a small town in California called Moraga. It's in the northern San Francisco Bay Area. And I'm the new assistant professor in exercise science. Exercise science can be anything from the physiology, how your body responds to bouts of exercise, to the psychological aspect. How do we overcome mental barriers associated with performance? And anything and everything in between. Biomechanics, how our joints move and how they work together to create movement, and how we acquire skills. right? The learning aspect of it as well. The SPEED Center stands for the Sport Performance Enhancement and Education Development Center. And it's a project that Chad here has created to work both working with our student athletes and our many athletic programs, but also an avenue to get students some experience working with student athletes, especially those who want to go into strength and conditioning. Chad and I have done, I think, a really good job of putting in the extra time to making sure students have access to us whenever they need or want. I know my door is always open, even when it's not open, it's open. And I check email, you know, all the way up until 10 p.m. at night, which most professors do. Yeah. Well, we've got two main concentrations, an allied health track and a fitness wellness track. We've also got two minors that I'm personally working on reworking. One is our coaching minor, and the other is our physical education minor. Where I'd like to make some adjustments and changes is to revamp both. Right now I'm working with the education department to sort out the credential requirements for teachers who might want to get a minor in PE if they want to go that route as well. I have a number of former students who actually have gone to PT school, one who's actually gone to OT school and they're graduating just now. I have a fellow colleague who's gone on to the University of Oregon and is now designing footwear. Her area specialty was in biomechanics. I've also got a number of colleagues working with the U.S. military, working on the mental training aspect. I also have another colleague working with the Milwaukee Bucks and working with their pre-draft analysis of prospects. A perfect student, in my opinion, is one who's engaged and willing to go the extra mile, right? Take what's gone over in lecture and really apply it outside, right? Bring in those outside ideas and let's discuss it a little bit further. Right? That's where the learning really takes place, the difference between learning and knowing. So, like, go get an attitude and the time, you know, willing to put in the time. That's really all, that's what differentiates person A from person B, how much time they're willing to put in.
What is success? I think it is a mixture of having a flair for the thing that you're doing, working hard, and having a certain sense of purpose. Margaret Thatcher. Assistant Professor of Nursing Sandy Blair has a heart for helping both patients and students. She's a member of the dedicated faculty that administers LaGrange College's Bachelor of Science in Nursing program, a program known for being tough every step of the way.
I've always loved being able to help people and to feel like you're doing something for someone else in a time of need. But also when it comes to the students, teaching them to not just take care of machines and equipment, but they're actually taking care of people and to not forget that. I really, truly do enjoy that. Nursing, as you probably know, is a very hard curriculum. They start their sophomore year with anatomy and physiology, getting ready for the program. Once they get here in the nursing program, we tell them that they're gonna have to get their family support to help them realize that for the next 2 years, there may be some things they can't always do with them, that they're gonna have to really make a commitment to this program. And it is discouraging for students. They'll come in our office and they're crying and upset. Most everyone up here are encouragers and really talk with them and help them with certain areas or how do they need to study better, how do they need to improve or what they might need to work on. But it is tough. I mean, it's tough for them, and it's tough for us sometimes to see them struggle so hard. But we try to help them through that period of time. Well, MediMan will be able to give them some great experience that they necessarily wouldn't get in the hospital setting even, that we can have situations set up that not everyone would get to practice with a particular patient in a hospital setting. Possibly setting them up where the patient has gone for heart catheterization and maybe there's some complications afterwards, and we can go through all of that and have MediMan be exactly and do exactly as a patient would do with complications.
It's good to see sometimes that light come on when they've started in our program, and you see after a year to a year and a half how they've grown and what they've learned and matured, and it just it's very exciting to us as faculty, and I love to see that in the students too, and how much they grow and they become critical thinkers, and they change. They really do change.
Action is the foundational key to all success. Pablo Picasso. Alvin Lingenfelter, assistant professor of religion, says that leadership is better demonstrated than taught in class. While in graduate school at Duke University, Professor Lingenfelter was fortunate enough to have an instructor teach him about praxis, a philosophy that analyzes a problem and then advocates getting personally involved in what's going on. The theory of praxis is something that Professor Lingenfelter encourages in all of his students. Talk things through, yes, he says, but then put on your gloves and lend a hand solving that problem.
Teaching students to serve is really simply showing them to serve. Working with them, whether it's service projects related to our cornerstone classes, whether it's sustainability efforts that the college is engaged in, whether it's the garden or in the community, kind of getting your hands dirty, almost like a dirty theology of sorts, to work diligently with them is the best model for teaching the students. This last Jan term, we had our inaugural Servant Leadership Jan Term courses. And we had three separate sections. Linda McMullen taught a course connected to the United Way, where she took students to volunteer and work and learn about United Way organizations, especially here in Troup County. John Ernstberger taught a class on sustainability and housing, where he actually took students to work on houses, working where they would do energy audits and various other forms of sustainable efforts on the houses. My class was focused on food, entitled Our Daily Bread, where we actually went to food co-ops and churches and other soup kitchens, where we learned about food insecurity and worked daily on the process of serving those people in that area. My journey as a servant leader honestly started with my parents. Started with my dad, who was a hardworking, blue-collar kind of guy who did the things that were necessary to support his family at a young age. He would often get me off the couch and out from in front of the television and outside to work and learn and participate in the neighborhood, in the community, and just hands-on work. And so his example and his teaching kind of put me on the road to this concept of praxis, of not just talking about the theory, but also enacting the theory and the process. And those are the things that were formulative. And of course, I have many mentors that I admire. Jim Wallace, Shane Claiborne, local mentors like Sim Blitch at Sim's Garden Patch, and Jenny and Chris Jackson at Jenny Jack Farms. And these are people who really embody who they are, their characters, and what they believe. One of the things that's really integral to what LaGrange does is connect students to opportunities to serve. And the college does that in a number of great ways. From the very first moment they set foot on campus, during first week, they're involved in a service-related project. From service Saturdays to service requirements for various clubs and organizations, to official activities that the college offers, like the alternative spring break trip, which this last year traveled to El Salvador to serve and work for a week, to opportunities on campus such as the campus garden, where they can work with their hands and have an impact on local agencies that need food, and also learn a skill, which is, you know, ultimately what we're hoping for.
Success is falling 9 times and getting up 10. John Bon Jovi.
A lot of students, when they first encounter math, they don't get it. They say, well, I'm not good at this, which is
just welcome to the group, you know, and the thing is perseverance. If you really want to reach the status of excellence, there's a period of struggling and effort, but then eventually you get to that point, and that's, that experience cannot be replaced by words. And also, if excellence is that easy, everybody will be excellent. But excellence only describes a few, so that's, I always remind students of that, in mathematics. But I think that's true for all aspects of life. And I think the key, when I first came to LaGrange College as a junior faculty, the senior faculty had talked, you know, the ones who guided me through my career here at the college had told me that we met students where they are, and but then we take them to beyond what they think they can ever achieve. I think that's our mission, that's what we were good at. But I think not until recent years that become a motto, so it's transforming life. You see that on a banner now, I really think that's what LaGrange is all about, transforming life. I hope this motto can become more visible, so the student willing to be transformed with open mind, when they hear about LaGrange College, they're willing to come to LaGrange College. But I think more than just we transform our student here, I hope LaGrange College take the motto even further from our institution, faculty, student, and staff together, transforming life around us in this community. So together, that's pretty much that's what education is about. You know, we're not in it for ourselves, but we're in it for the community, for the society, to elevate the entire society. So hopefully that's what college in the future can be recognized as that.
We have an incredible English faculty. I'm so proud to be a member of the faculty here at LaGrange College. The English program begins with a solid foundation of writing, and that writing is geared to having students learn to think more collaboratively in one sense than they may at present, which means a lot of back and forth in terms of writing, revision. All students have a whole year of writing before they can go on to other interdisciplinary courses here in the core. And one is an expository writing course and the other is about analysis of literature. And again, that's another way that I think we work at building interdisciplinary an interdisciplinary sense in our courses, because they're sort of writing across the curriculum topics that we take up. When I learned from Professor Barbara Knoll that they'll do the cherry orchard, I began to think of ways that I can incorporate things about the cherry orchard into courses that I teach. We have a lot of opportunities for interdisciplinariness in our work. We have students who do extremely well in law school who have English majors here. They can major in other things, of course, but and go to law school. But we have a great track record of students, several at the present time who are in law school who were English majors, strong English majors, and did a lot of writing. And there are, of course, they go to graduate school in journalism as well from our undergraduate program. Doesn't, you know, what your major is, whether you're going to be a teacher or a doctor or a lawyer or an accountant, we want you to be a good one of those. We want you to be people who are persons of integrity in your professional and personal lives, and that this has been the sort of golden time, the 4 or sometimes 5 years, when someone learns not only who they are but and what they're going to do, but acquires a kind of philosophy of life that is consistent with the ideals of LaGrange College and civility, diversity, service, and excellence.
You've just met 8 people who have found successful careers. Successful careers helping and teaching other people. They love what they do, they love where they do it, and they just happen to work at LaGrange College. Why did we want to introduce you to 8 successful teachers? Because it's never too late to earn your teaching credentials and step into a classroom as a member of the most creative, happiest professions in America. Visit the LaGrange College website and discover what it takes to become a classroom teacher. You can do it no matter your age, and it's more affordable than you might think. LaGrange College. Here, every student can discover his or her own measure of success.